I am now so paranoid that my video is going to cut off after 4 minutes when I am interviewing my buddy ST tonight, that I've decided to try and record a full 15-minute video and see if it will work. So, in doing so, I can continue to promote Dead But Dreaming 2. I've signed half of my bookmarks already. So, got that many signed, and I've got that many more to go. So that's about half. So, Robert Bloch was a correspondent of mine. I began to correspond with him when I was in high school. No, I had just graduated from high school, and I was doing a magazine, a film. I was really into horror films. I wasn't reading horror fiction. I was watching movies, and I was obsessed with becoming a horror film actor. That was going to be my profession. And Robert wrote for one of my horror film fanzines back in 1970 or 1971. And then I was sent to Ireland as a Mormon missionary. And I wasn't allowed to watch horror films. I was still corresponding with Bob, and so I began to buy Robert Bloch novels in British paperback, and then I began to hunt for horror anthologies in which Bob was one of several writers. And that's how I got hooked on reading horror fiction. And Bob inspired me to try my own hand at writing fiction, and so I did. And his own stories were a huge influence. That skull is not this skull. So I'm doing it. This is about the skull. So I want the skulls anyway. Wait. His own fiction had a real impact on my early writing, and there was one story of his, and it was called The Skull of the Marquis de Sade, and I really love that story. This is, I believe I bought this book in, let's see, I don't think I could have bought this book in Ireland, because this paperback wasn't published until 1976. So, but this is the only book in which I have this story, The Skull of the Marquis de Sade. I just really, really like this story a lot. And I wanted to write my own sequel of it, and I told Bob that, and he was amused, I guess. We mentioned it off and on in my correspondence with him over the years, but I was never able to write that story, and I tried for 20 years. Sometimes you just don't find the right ideas or the right mood or the right whatever to work on a story that an idea that intrigues you. I'm still peeling super glue off my fingers. The Skull, of course, was filmed by Amicus. A wonderful portrayal of the skull's owner by Peter Cushing. had some imaginative camera work. So, been wanting and wanting and wanting to, write a sequel to Robert Bloch's The Skull. And when I say sequel, it's not... My sequels are rarely direct sequels. I think the only story that was a direct sequel was some distant baying sound, which was a direct sequel to H.P. Lovecraft's The Hound. I finally wrote the story. Came to just a brief 3,000 words, but I was pleased with it. And so that was the story that I submitted to Dead But Dreaming 2, which will soon be published by Miskatonic River Press. And everyone that pre-orders this book will get this special bookmark signed by me. There we are. So, So I thought, as a part of a promotion, I may have read a portion of this story before. I'm going to read some of it now. I wrote it in a colloquial style that was influenced by the narrative style that Lovecraft used in Pickman's Model. So that was the inspiration for my style of this story. So I'm going to just read a bit of it, not all of it, because if you want to read all of it, you'll need to buy the book, my darlings. But see, I'm right up to 7 minutes almost. We shall see if this video works. This is a test. This is merely a test. Do not try to adjust your screen. We will control the vertical. We will control the horizontal. The name of the story is Your Ivory Hollow by W.H. Pugmire. Yes, I know I seem a bit nervous. Here, let me pour us a drink. This is from South Africa, and although they are noted for their white wines, I think this red is especially good. Ah, that's better. My nerves have been on edge since our friend's death. I miss him more than I can say. He led me into a world such as I have never encountered, an intoxicating realm. And now that he is gone, that world haunts my ivory shell with dim and dreamy reveries. I have a feeling that you too know these things because of your secret heritage. No, don't look surprised. You must realize by now that Johan and I shared everything, that we had no secrets from each other. We were brother poets as well as lovers, and our passion was for decadent literature, as you know. It was his aim to write something that would astound the prosaic world, something similar to the way that Baudelaire so astonished his age. Well, Johan has certainly shocked the world. I think over the decades, his last book will take on new significance and power. It has already led to one suicide, which is such a compliment. Ah, your eyes keep shifting to that ornamental box. I have no idea where he found it, but I know what he used it for. It's made of resin, and the inlaid motif on the lid is gold. It's rather heavy, although it no longer holds its former occupant. But I keep the other thing inside it, that small, unearthly gem. Go ahead, open it. The lid is heavier than one expects, almost as if it protests the touch of your silver hand, your attempt to explore its mystery. Yes, take it out. The small black gem looks so lovely against the mesh of your antique gloves. You can see, of course, the hollow indentation left by the thing for which the box had been composed, the smooth, small skull. When Johann first showed it to me, I mistook it for the delicate cranium of some woman, and thus I was astounded when he revealed to me that the skull belonged, in fact, to the Marquis de Sade. Do you smile? I smiled too, I confess. Johann's imagination was what one would have called extravagant. His means were modest, and I told myself that such a gem as the skull of the Scarlet Marquis would be a costly treasure. And yet, the first time he actually showed me the thing, I confess that it had its weird effect. Indeed, I took it for some artifact cleverly composed, but obviously fake. It was small and looked frangible. It's a weird word. I've never used that word before. It was small and looked frangible. Its surface was yellow with age, yet well preserved, except for the small hollow that had formed below the brow bone. It took me some time to realize what made this skull so utterly different from any others I had encountered. It was as I studied the row of teeth and finely structured jaw that I suddenly noticed it did not grin. I am prone to bad nerves, as you know, and for a moment I was stiff with horror. My flesh prickled and I grew slightly dizzy. An overwhelming sense of imminent danger engulfed my being. As I studied the skull, I felt a weird sensation that I was part of some mesmerized crowd who ogled it adoringly. I could feel their sensuous eyes behind and above me. As I studied the grim thing, Johann spoke of it in his remarkable voice, that voice that so captivated audiences when he read his work publicly. You'll probably think it's a fake, Frank, but I can assure you I know otherwise. I've been sleeping with it beside me, which has resulted in uncanny dreams. Dreaming is a form of magic if you do it right. It can transform space and time. I lived De Sade's secret life, the one for which we have rumors only, his life as a sorcerer. He trafficked with demons of the pit, with devils in the deep abysses above. He tried to whisper their names to me, but his voice was like the wind and I could not understand it. He revealed, darkly, the thing that squatted in its subterranean cavern for centuries, hungry for homages of carnage. He revealed the shapes that fell to earth, the beings who brought their images with them. I remember them especially, keenly, and so you can imagine my reaction when I encountered a woman with one of those images carved in obsidian and fastened to a necklace that she wore. All right, I will stop there. Let's see how much time I have. All right, almost 14 minutes. Have a little frog in my throat, so that was a very bad reading, but oh well. So that is my story for Dead But Dreaming 2. A book that will soon be published by Miskatonic River Press. And I'm in there with a lot of other really good writers. The first book has garnered rave reviews at Amazon.com. So I think this sequel, Dead But Dreaming 2, will be a marvelous success. So if you pre-order it, you get this signed by moi. Okay, darlings? There you go. Signed by me.